I tell you the reason why he is so great and he was a man of God is because of his mother. This is a woman who prayed. This is a woman who knew how to pray. This is a woman who is teaching you and me today the power of prayer. She reminds me and reminds you that persistence in prayer is important. Don't give up on your prayer. Hannah went every year to the temple to pray and came back empty. And the year after she went to pray and she came back empty. And she went one time to pray and eventually it happened. God listened to our prayer. We talked about this woman enduring four hardships in her life. The first hardship and the first tribulation in her life came from God Almighty when He closed her womb and she couldn't have children. The second difficulty in this woman's life came from her husband when he found her barren, chose to remarry another woman who can give him children. The third difficulty in her life came to her from her second wife, where she treated her difficulty. And last but not least, Eli the priest judged her and thought she was drunk. Before I go more into today's sermon, I want to talk to you about this slide. A sacrifice and the cross, they are one and the same. This sacrifice, this lamb that's given on the altar of sacrifice, was a picture, was a foreshadow, was telling that one day the Son of God will come and will die. Anything that happens to a sacrifice, as if it's happening with Christ. The same annotation to the lamb is the same for Christ. They are one of the same. Doing wrong with the sacrifice is exactly doing wrong with Christ our Lord. One more thing about sacrifices. I want you to know this title or this meaning, this substitutionary progressive atonement. Big word, what does it mean? It means that when Adam and Eve sinned and something went wrong with them, then God sacrificed an animal so that to cover their nakedness. That was one animal for one man, one animal for one person, for Adam or for Eve. And then we read the story of Moses and the Passover, where every family had to sacrifice one animal and put the blood on top of the doorpost. And we read here that we moved from one animal to one person to one sacrifice for one family. And then when the Jewish times came and God spoke to them in Leviticus, He told them, well, one sacrifice is good enough for the whole community. And eventually, in the right time, Jesus came and He sacrificed Himself for the whole world. The importance of sacrifice, because today is an insult towards the sacrifices of God. What do we see here? The sacrifices were of many kinds. One of the sacrifices was called the burned sacrifice. What does that mean? That means that the sinner would come and put his hand on the head of the sacrifice and all of the sins symbolically would transfer to that animal and then the animal will be sacrificed or slaughtered. And this is a burnt offering. All the animal, everything in it is burnt. It's barbecued. Nobody eats from it. Nobody touches it. Continues to burn until it is ashes, and then they would collect the ashes and put it away. This kind of sacrifice is called the burned sacrifice. But the sacrifice that I want to talk to you about when the sin happened was this different type of sacrifice. It's called the fellowship sacrifice. Why fellowship? Because you can see here that the man who would offer the sacrifice would sit with all his family members on a table and invite the priest and his family, and they would all eat from the sacrifice. Eat the meat that was barbecued on the altar. They would eat it and be full and satisfied. And they would have fellowship and love with one another. And the Bible calls it this a fellowship or peace offering because it symbolizes the peace that Christ our God brought between mankind and heaven, between sinners and God Almighty, the Holy God, this peace that happened before them. If you read in Leviticus the insides of this sacrifice, it's really interesting. God told Moses this sacrifice, you open, slaughter the animal, open the insides of the animal, and you take all the fat. You can see that arrow with the yellow coloring. All the fat. And you put that fat on the altar. And the altar will have fire and the fat will be consumed. Don't take anything of the fat. God specifically says, the fat is mine. Why? Why is that important? Think of the dinner you had last night. What makes a dish so tasty, so nice? Is it because it's cooked very healthy, or because we can put a lot of fat and oil in it? The more fat you put in a dish, the more the dish tastes nice. And so fat tells you that there's richness in it. God wants to tell Moses and his people, the best thing in the animal sacrifice, the best, the fat, the best thing, I want it for myself. And the same thing till today. God wants to tell us, I want the best from you. Give me the best. I know people that give God the least. I know people that would go and when it's time to collect some donations or give offerings in the church, they will give that $10 bill that's already cut in pieces and ripped. And not even the Tim Hortons guy is ready to accept it. He says, that's bad money. That's the $10 where people put in the donation box. No, we ought to give God the best of what we have. The greatest of what, the best of your time, the best of your energy, the best of your finances, the best of your thinking. Give God the best. The fat was the best and God demanded it. Take the fat and put it on the altar and I will have it as an aroma pleasing to me. Okay, great. That part we understand about the fellowship or peace sacrifice. What else did God tell Moses? God told Moses, well, I want you from that sacrifice, from that lamb, from that cow, from that ox that's on the altar, I want you to take the right leg of that animal, the right leg, and the chest meat. The right leg and the chest meat. Don't touch it. You take that part, the right leg and the chest meat, and you offer it to your priest. Why? Why is that particular part relevant? And Bible scholars will tell us because the right leg, your right leg, is much stronger than your left leg. The right is always a symbol of power. And God wants to tell the priest that I am your power. I am protecting you. I am covering over you. I am your inheritance. Your power comes from me. And that's the symbol of why I take the right thigh. God also told Moses, make sure that they take the chest meat and give it to the priest. Why? Bible scholars tell us because the chest meat is closest to the animal's heart. God wants to tell the Levite priests that you people, you are my servants. You are very close to my heart. So take the right thigh, give it to the priest. Take the chest meat, give it to the priest after you've taken the fat of the sacrifice and burned it. And then the rest of it you can eat. We will see very soon that the people of Eli did not follow these instructions. All this was happening in a place called Shiloh, where the tabernacle of God was. And we will quickly learn, and I'm almost done here, that the two sons of Eli died because they disrespected God. They did not follow his explicit instructions. Or as the Bible says here, you did not follow my prescription. For the pharmacists and the doctors in the audience, this was a prescription on how to make a sacrifice before God. This was not the first time two priests died. Do you remember these two people? Who remembers these two guys? They were called Nadab and Abihu, and both priests offered ungodly or unauthorized sacrifice before God. And many Bible scholars say that they did that when they were drunk. And we talked a lot at Hosanna here about the importance of not getting drunk when you come before God. Don't be drunk when you're coming to worship. Don't drink and come and pray. Be careful of that particular sacrifice. Follow the instructions of God clearly. Those two priests died back then, and today we're going to see that those two wicked sons of Eli also died because they were wicked. I want you, as I'm talking, to think about two people, Samuel on one side and the wicked priests on the other side. They both lived under the same roof. They both lived inside the temple. The priests were wicked and Samuel were godly. The priests were ungodly and Samuel was a man of God. And yes, it is true, you and I and our children can survive even if the world outside us is bad. Samuel did it. Samuel was living at the time of Judges when everything was corrupt, including the priests' sons. The first thing they did wrong, as I said, was their liturgical sins. Wrong sins they did in the Bible. The Bible tells us that this was the practice, that people would come and they would dip their plunge into the pan, as you see in the picture, the kettle or the pot, and the priest would take from him whatever the fork brought up. This was wrong. They should have taken just the right thigh, or the chest, or both. But these priests, they wanted to take the best. This is how they treated the Israelites who came to Shiloh. Verse 15 tells us, but the priests of Eli, even before the fat was burned, the servant of the priest would come and would take the meat and will tell to the man, give the priest the meat to roast. He will not accept any kind of meat. He doesn't like the boiled meat. Greedy priests. They did not respect God's sacrifice. They stole the meat from the families, and you can see them here eating and drinking from it. If the man who's offering the sacrifice will say to the priest, but sir, let the fat be burnt up first, then take whatever you want. But then the priest would say, no, hand it over to me, because if you don't, I will take it by force. The two sons of Eli were wicked priests. One of them was called Phinehas. Do you remember this other man? There are two Phinehases in the Bible. One of them is called Phinehas, son of Eleazar. Who remembers this man? This was a very righteous man. When the people of God were marrying and sleeping with ungodly women, and God was not happy with them, he brought an illness upon the Israelites. And this man, Eleazar, stopped the disease from killing all the Israelites because he went into the tent and found a man having a relationship with an ungodly woman, and he took a blade and he passed that blade through his belly, and it went right through him and her together. And God stopped the plague that was happening. This was a godly man, Phinehas, son of Eleazar. Eleazar was also a priest. This is in comparison to Phinehas of today. They're both Phinehases, but one was godly and one was ungodly. The Bible describes here their sin. The sin of the young men was very great in the Lord's sight, for they were treating the offering with contempt. Not only that, the Bible tells us that these priests were also morally wrong. And as you can see in the picture here, which tells you how much people at the time of Judges were terrible, the priests used to flirt and have sexual relationship with the women who were serving at the temple. They used to wash the brass stains after the meat has been eaten and the barbecue. They would come and clean it. And this man, Phinehas, and his brother, the sons of Eli, used to do sexual things with these women. The Bible is very clear. He says that they slept with the women who served at the entrance to the tent. I want to tell you that Phinehas was a married man. That priest was married and he had children. Yet when he would go to the temple, he would fall into adultery and make sin with these women. And not only that, it's amazing that he would commit such crime. Where? Where? Not in his home, not in the hotel, not in in Mexico, but he would commit such sin inside the temple. The location of the sin was unbelievable. And you and I also, if we commit such sin, we are also sinning against the temple of God. Don't you know that in today's world, you and I are the temple of the Holy Spirit? Please be careful about such sins. The Bible describes the sin of sexual issues and adultery and fornication as a highway to the grave. Look what the wisest man that lived on earth said about this sin of adultery. Do not let your heart turn to her ways. That's the sinful man or the sinful woman. Do not stray in her path. Why? Because many are the victims she has brought down, and her slain are a mighty people. Yes, David, King David was a mighty king who fell into that kind of sin. And Solomon tells us that when it comes to adultery and the adulterous man or adulterous woman, her house, this woman's house, this woman or this man or this relationship is a highway, look at the Bible, to the grave. A highway to the grave, leading down to the chambers of death. Here we can see that Eli was kind of hearing about those two sons of his. Do you know what the Bible preaches about the punishment, or the reward, I should say, or the punishment of adulterous people or ungodly people? A rebellious son, the Bible says, should be dealt with by stoning to death. The people came to Eli and they told him, your sons are doing such and such and such bad things. They are stealing the meat from the sacrifice. They are sinning with the women. Please do something about it. And as you can see in the picture, and we discussed that, what did he do? He simply spoke to them. He just rebuked them a little bit. Guys, please stop what you are doing. He said to them, why do you do such things? I hear from all people about the wicked deeds you are doing. No, my sons, it is not good. And he simply spoke to them like that. How did his sons take it? The sons did not believe. The sons did not take it seriously. The sons ignored their parents' or their father's rebuke. The book of Proverbs say, only a fool despises a parent's discipline, but he who learns correction is wise. Sometimes it's important that we listen to what others are saying, especially if they have more experience, especially if they have shown that they are people of God. Yes, indeed, I agree with this. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but instead bring them up with training and instruction. It's important that we train our children. It's important that we instruct our children. It's important that we look after our children and teach them and rebuke them. The book of Proverbs say, whoever spares the rod hates their children. But the one who loves their children is careful to discipline them. Not the rod that hits mostly with the rod, but sometimes the words that you use can be as a rod. Sometimes the rod is the most effective means of correction. Sadly, too many children today control their parents instead of the parents controlling their children. Let's remember to teach our children the fear of God. Eli, the priest, they did not show respect to their father. They did not listen to their father. And I tell you, Eli's fault is not today. It started from when they were young. He didn't discipline them to love God. He didn't discipline to respect God and His word. Quickly, let's move on to this other slide where we talk and contrast the two wicked sons of Eli with young Samuel, where his mother brings him to Eli the priest. Look at this slide. The Bible describes this slide. He says Samuel was ministering before God, and he was a boy, and he was wearing his ephod. You see that ephod on the insert on the right? It is that special jacket that only priests would wear. The Bible says that each year his mother made him a little robe and took it to him when she went up with her husband to offer the annual sacrifice. I could even see Elkanah, her husband, and Hannah, as they are giving the new coat or jacket to Samuel, they're telling him, remember, love God, fear God, follow His commandments, read the Torah, be careful that you pray, be careful that you fast, be careful that you offer sacrifice. I can see Hannah giving her children the milk that would get them to grow to be godly people when they are older. Amazing how this young boy saw his parents once a year. One time a year. The Bible says only once a year they would meet his father and his mother. And Samuel was a great child. And Eli blessed these two couple. And as we talked last time, Hannah, the barren woman, had more children. She had five more children. Amazing miracles with God. And the Bible says that the boy Samuel continued to grow in stature and in favor with God. Are you growing with God? Am I growing with God? Am I today in my relationship with God one step ahead than last year? Is my prayer today a little deeper than my prayer life 2 years ago? Is there a growth that's happening in my spiritual life? I tell you, if your life is not growing as Samuel's did, if your spiritual life is stunted, if there's no growth in your stature with God, something is not right. Something is not right. Either the way you live, or either the way you practice your faith, something is not right. I expect grace to talk to me in a certain way. But Daniel talks to me in a different way. And then Juliana, who's much older, she talks to me in a different way. Growth is important. Are you growing? Am I growing? Are we growing in our life and in our knowledge and in our walk with God or not? Important question to ask yourself. Remember that in all this badness, Samuel lived a righteous life. Don't tell me the people are bad outside and that's why I fell into sin. Not a good excuse. I remember Daniel and his three friends when they went to the Persian people, to King Nebuchadnezzar, and he wanted to serve them food and wine and meat that was offered to the sacrifices. They said, no, we don't want it. We're going to eat our food. We're going to drink our godly drink. And after 10 days, they were measured, and as you know the story, they were strong. They kept themselves clean. What I love about God is when Eli made such great sin with his children, and the children did wrong, he did not leave him alone. He sent him a warning, and the warning came to Eli through a prophet. The Bible does not disclose the name of that prophet. We don't know who he is. We don't know what his name is, who his father or mother is. But we know that God sent him that prophet to warn him. Many times, we too, when we're walking the wrong path, God would send us a little warning. Be careful that your eye and your ear can hear and see what the warnings that God is speaking to you. If you are walking in a wrong way, the warnings that you are walking through. That prophet spoke to Eli. And God spoke through the prophet. What did God tell Eli? He told him these questions. Why do you scorn my sacrifice? And why do you scorn my offerings that I prescribe to my dwelling? Today, if that applies to one of us, If you feel rebuked in your heart when you read this question, that maybe you too are also treating Christ, the sacrificial Lamb of God, ignorantly, that you are treating His commandments and you're scorning it, you're not taking it seriously, you're living an ungodly life, if you feel that you're going wrong, walking in sin, doing things that are far from holiness of God, stop and remember this question. Why do you scorn me? God is saying. And here God is telling Eli, why do you honor your sons more than me? Christ said to his disciples, anyone who loves their father or their mother or their friends or anything else more than me is not worthy of me. That includes the sons and the daughters. Matthew 10:47. Love God first and foremost. And the prophet says to Eli something very difficult. He tells him, you are taking the sacrifice and you are fattening yourselves on the choice parts of every offering. And yes, the priests ate a lot of fat and they became fat. And I want to take a moment about this picture. Talking to you about Eli and his sons. They were obese. I wanted not to talk about physical obesity. I want just to prescribe for you this term. Many of us are the very same like Eli and his priests. We are spiritually obese. We know so much. We hear so many sermons. We listen to so many talks. We listen and read the Bible and read stories of the saints and so many theoretical knowledge, but it's all theory. I don't put it into practice. I grow fat and fat and fat and fat, and it's all theory. Don't do that. Exercise the fat that's inside of you. Exercise and put your faith in practice. And the prophet tells him, those who honor me, I will honor. And this is a beautiful verse. You can go tonight in your prayer and say to God, I heard that you will honor those who honor you. God, I honor you with everything I do. To the faithful, you show yourself faithful. And you know what happened with Eli and his family, that the prophet said things about them, that they will have the priesthood taken from them, that all their descendants are going to die at a young age, that the people of Eli and his house will become poor, and that Hophni and Phinehas, they will both die on the same day. When the prophet gave that warning, did they listen? No. Did they care? No. They didn't. They ignored it. They continued to eat and drink and get themselves fat. Please, if God is sending you a message, be careful. Don't be like those priests. In my mind, those are fake Christians. There is many people today, and I can talk about fake Christianity. Why? Because I was like that before. Before I've come to know Christ, I was exactly like those priests. I would come here on Sunday, and I'd attend Mass, and I would feel great. And then Monday to Saturday was my week. My day, I lived life the way I wanted to be. And then I would look good on Sunday again for church and before the people of God. Fake Christians. Don't be a fake Christian. Don't be a fake Christian. Looks like a Christian, but you're not. Looks like a believer, but you act differently. The way you talk is different. The way you dress is different. The movies you watch are different. The way you spend your money is different. Your friends are different. Those you call yourself Christian, but in reality, we are not. Be careful. Be careful. Do you know that only the people inside the Ark of Noah were saved from the flood? Only those inside the Ark. Make sure that you are real and that you are living inside the Ark. People who were away from the Ark were flooded and died. People who were half a mile from the Ark, they were flooded and died. People who were standing right next to the Ark were also flooded and they died. But only those inside the Ark. Are you in Christ? Are you a real Christian. The last part is we see Eli and Samuel, the young boy, going to bed. They are going to bed. They are going to sleep. They have served God all day, and it's time for them to say their night prayers, and they are going to sleep. And we see that God speaks to Samuel in chapter 3, and the Bible says that the lamp of God, which is the altar lamp, had not yet gone out. The lamp used to light from midnight till the next morning. So the oil would start to fade away by 4 or 5 a.m. in the morning. And the Bible scholars say that's probably around the time when God spoke to Samuel. And it's interesting that Samuel used to sleep inside the temple. There were two people inside the temple sleeping, Samuel and Eli, the young servant and the high priest. But when God chose to speak, who did he choose? He chose the young boy. He had the heart of God. He had the mind of Christ. It doesn't matter how young you are. Don't let anybody despise your knowledge of God. You don't have to have gray hair to be a man of God. Even young people can have a purer, cleaner heart than older people like myself. Number two, please notice here, my beloved, Samuel at that time was about 12 years old. Who started the discussion? Who started the dialogue? Who called whom? Was it Samuel that spoke to God? I tell you, no. The Bible tells us that it was the other way around, that God spoke to Samuel. God always initiates. God always starts the discussion. God is trying to reach out. He wants to talk to us. He wants to tell us it is about time. And number three, God spoke to Samuel by his name. The Bible says here that he called him Samuel, Samuel. Yes, God knows your name. God knows your name very well. God knows my name. God knows your name, who you are, whatever your name is. God knows you by name, and he called him by name. And he spoke to him once and twice. Every time Samuel will run to Eli, and he will tell him, "Did you call me master?" And then Eli will tell him, "Go back, it wasn't me." The third time, Eli, with his knowledge of God, I can't say that he knew God very well, but his knowledge of God, he told Samuel this verse: "When you hear God or Samuel calling you again, answer and say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" That's a great prayer. Every time you come to church, that's a lovely prayer to say, "Speak, Lord, because your servant is listening." Every time you hear a sermon, say, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." Every time you come to Hosanna, say the same thing: "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." And that was the only way Samuel would know God. I want to say the importance of Eli in the life of Samuel. Samuel would not have recognized that this was God's voice had not Eli told him, "This is how you should do." What I'm trying to tell you is, it's important to have a spiritual leader guide you. What I'm trying to tell you is, it's important to have a father of confession guide you. You think you know it all, and you think you are very good and very spiritual, and you don't need nobody. You are wrong. We all need a father of confession. We all need somebody to guide us to the right way. We don't know it all. We don't understand everything. It's important to have somebody speak to you, to guide you to God's way. Last but not least, God spoke to Samuel, and you can read for yourself. He wasn't happy with Eli, and he told Samuel, "Go and tell Eli that you and your house, you will all die." I wanted to spend 30 seconds on this title. How do you hear God's voice? I asked the question a million times. How do I know it is God who is speaking to me? How do I know that this is God's will for me? How do I know that this is the right thing for me? Number one, how do you recognize God's voice if it aligns with his word? If the voice you are hearing, if the feeling you have in your heart, when the Spirit is talking to you, tells you to walk a certain way, and that way doesn't contradict what the Word of God says, that is the right way. Number two, God's voice is rarely loud. God's voice is rarely abrasive. God's voice is rarely a pushing voice. It's always a very calm voice. It's always a very cool, collected voice. There is no force when it comes to God's voice. Christ said, "My sheep listen to me. I know them, and they follow me." God told Samuel, "Eli is going to die." The next morning, Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, come over here. What did God tell you yesterday?" Samuel was at first afraid to tell him. But Eli insisted. And then Samuel, the Bible says, told Eli everything. He told him everything that God said. Although the message was difficult, he told it to him. Sometimes we need to pass the message of God to people as it is. Meaning you don't need to dilute the message. You don't need to make it nice so that people would like you. You don't need to sugarcoat the message so that it is soft on people's heart. Oh, God is so lovey-dovey. Oh, God does not hurt. Oh, God is this. Oh, God is that. But my beloved, you and I as Christians, we need to give the message to the people of the world as it is, without changing. And the last slide or two, Eli told it to him the way it was. And the last verse of today is this: the Lord was with Samuel. The Lord was with Samuel. Samuel grew up and God blessed him and he became a priest himself. The Lord was with Samuel. I want to tell you that God is not only with Samuel. Look with me, if you will, on the slide. This man, his name is Abraham. The Bible tells me that God was with Abraham and he talked to him in person. Look at this man. This is a man who wrestled with God and God spoke to him and he told him, "I will not let you unless you bless me." Who is this man? Jacob. What about this man? This man is the young, clear, clean, perfect, godly Joseph. And the Bible says that God was with Joseph and he prospered in everything he did. He became the second man in the whole nation of Egypt. What about this man? This man that parted the sea with his stick. God spoke with Moses. The Bible tells me that God was with Moses. How about this man which we talked about a year or two ago? This man is Joshua. And the Bible on more than one occasion says that God spoke and was with Joshua, telling him, "Do not be afraid." How about this man? Who remembers this man and his assistant who went to sneak at the tents at nighttime? This man is called Gideon. The Bible says that God was with Gideon, and so he succeeded in his wars. How about this man, this young boy, who later became a king, and he was able to defeat the muscular big Goliath? This man is King David. The Bible says that God was with King David. St. Paul, God was with him. Forget about all these examples. Jesus said the last verse in the book of Matthew. He told everyone as he was rising up on the mountain, going up to heaven, "And surely I am with you always, until the very end of age." God is with you. God is with us. Don't be afraid. As God was with Samuel, he is with everybody else. Three things before we close with the final song. First thing we learned today: number one, treat God's sacrifice with dignity. Treat Christ our Lord with respect. Treat the sacrifice of God with proper dignity. Number two, be careful about sexual sin. You can be young, you will fall. You can be old, you will fall. You can be single, you may fall. You can be married, you will be attacked. You can have gray hair, you may be attacked. Be careful from sexual sin. Last but not least, learn to recognize the voice of God. Learn to train your ears to hear the voice of God. It's a calm voice. It's a soothing voice. It's not a forceful voice. It's not a pushy voice. It's a voice that will always follow what the church fathers teach. If you hear the voice talking up against the church fathers, it is wrong. If you hear the voice talking against what the church teaches, it is wrong. If you hear the comments and the Facebook and the posts talk about against the Bible, it is wrong. These are all not the voice of God.
Hosanna Bible Study Group meets every Friday, 7:30 p.m. till 9:30 p.m. at SMSV Church, 3300 Highway 7 East Markham. The website is hosannabiblestudy.com, where you can sign up for weekly emails and you will get emails about the upcoming lecture and the questions and everything else. Thank you.